Hello everyone, I, Sandeep Kaur, on behalf of AD Instruments, welcome you all to our today's webinar. Today's webinar on vagus, a clinical autonomic window to neuropsychiatric disorders. It is our privilege to have with us three eminent professors from NIMHANS, Bengaluru. Professor T.N. Satyaprabha, Dr. Kaviraj Uthuppa, and Dr. G. Venkateswaramanan. Our first speaker for today's scientific session need no introduction, as she has been awarded with several prestigious awards like Kalpana Chawla Award, Sushil Thakur Award, S.B. Deshpande Award. She is none other than Dr. Professor T.N. Satyaprabha. She completed her MBBS from KIMS, Bengaluru in 1988. And after which she did her MD in physiology from BMC, Bengaluru. Her area of recent research are cardiac autonomic function in neuropsychiatric disorder, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, yoga and Ayurveda. She has published 129 papers, 2,162 citations, H index 26. She is currently heading the Department of Neurophysiology, NIMHANS, and also she is the in charge of Autonomic Lab and Cell Culture Stem Cell Biology Laboratory. And she is presently the president of Society of Neuroscience Bangalore chapter. So today I welcome Dr. Professor T.N. Satyaprabha to start the session. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, Sandeep Kaur, and a very good afternoon to all the members who are logged in now. And first of all, I thank Dr. Kaviraj and Dr. Sandeep, and of course Sumanth, who invited me to give a talk. And I hope I'll do the justice. So a warm welcome from Namma Bengaluru to all of you. So I'll start now. I have to share the screen, right? Yeah. Can you see the screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I'll be talking on physiology of the vagus nerve and clinical investigation of cardiac autonomic functions. Just a second, my toolbar is under focusing on the thing. Yeah. First few slides, I'll be talking on vagus nerve and its anatomy and the physiology. Then I'll go to the how do we do the autonomic function test. We all know that vagus is the longest and the most complex of the 12 layers of cranial nerves that come from the brain. And vagus is the 10th cranial nerve. The name it has got from the Latin wander, that is the wandering nerve, because it supplies all parts of the body. So it can be head, neck, and the intestine, etc., etc. The origin of this vagus nerve, it has got sensory and the motor origin. The motor originates from the nodus ganglion, whereas the sensory fibers come from the neurons of the dorsal motor nucleus and the tractus solitorius. And you can see here, this vagus nerve leaves the medulla oblongata on each side and passes anteriorly. And then it comes out, leaving the skull in the foramen oval, jugular foramen. And then it is accompanied by glossopharyngeal nerve, that is the 9th cranial nerve, and also the accessory nerve. So you can see all the three nerves together here and also here. There are two sensory ganglion in each of the vagus nerve at the jugular foramen. It is the superior vagal ganglion and the inferior vagal ganglion. And it continues in the neck within the carotid sheath. This is the carotid sheath. Along with that, it continues. And the vagus nerve has got number of functions. There are mainly four important key functions in the vagus. One is the sensory. The sensation from the throat, heart, lungs, and the abdomen. And it has got a special sensory that provides the taste sensation behind the tongue. And motor, it provides the movement of the muscle responsible for the swallowing and the speech. And the last one is the parasympathetic. Vagus nerve plays an important role in the parasympathetic nervous system, and it is responsible for the digestion, digestive tract, respiration, and of course, heart functioning. Coming to the sensory function of the vagus, the sensory function of the vagus divided into two components. One is the somatic component and the visceral component. The somatic component is from the skin and the muscle, and the visceral component from the visceral organs. And these sensory functions of the vagus nerve include providing the somatic sensation information from the skin, especially behind the ear, external part of the ear canal, and certain parts of the throat. And supplying the visual sensation information from the larynx, esophagus, lungs, trachea, heart, and most of the digestive tract. Also, it plays a small role in the sensation of the taste near the root of the tongue. Coming to motor functions of the vagus now, it stimulating the muscles of the pharynx, larynx, soft palate, which is the fleshy area near the back of the tongue or the roof of the mouth. And it stimulates the involuntary contraction of the digestive tract, including the esophagus, stomach, and most of the intestine, which allows the food movement in the tract. So other part of the functions are the is the autonomic functions of the vagus nerve. So we all know that heart is innervated by sympathetic and parasympathetic fibers, and heart receives by both right and the left vagus, and these are the responsible for the heart rate, cardiac output, and force of contraction. This force of contraction is not by the direct, because the vagus muscle do not supply the cardiac muscle, but it supplies the AV node and the SA node. In turn, it indirectly helps in the force of contraction. The right vagus now primarily innervates the SA node, and the left vagus now the AV node. The red one is the parasympathetic vagus now, and this purple one is the sympathetic now. You can see here, this vagus now supplies mainly to the SA node and the AV node, that is the conducting system of the heart, not other part of the heart, like it may be blood vessels or it can be the heart muscle. Whereas the sympathetic system supplies the AV node, SA node, also the blood vessels and the cardiac muscle. In 1628, William Harvey hinted the link between brain and the heart when he wrote, for every affection of the mind that is attended with either pain or pleasure, hope or fear, is the cause of the agitation whose influences extend to the heart. This picture shows the complete autonomic nervous system. You can see the autonomic nervous system starts from the eye to the rectum, both sympathetic and parasympathetic. It has got a wide collection. So I always say this autonomic nervous system is the unsung hero of the both disease and when the healthy individual. It has got a wide range, but this is not popularly known compared to the any other nervous system. Coming to autonomic innervation of the heart, cardiac autonomic nervous system can be divided into eccentric and the intrinsic component. The eccentric component of autonomic nervous system fibers, it comprises the fibers that mediate connection between heart and the nervous system, the brain and the heart, that is the eccentric one. The intrinsic cardiac autonomic nervous system consists of primarily autonomic tone fiber, autonomic nerve fibers when they enter the pericardial tissue here. So till then it is eccentric, and when they enter it is the intrinsic. Coming to eccentric, it is both sympathetic and parasympathetic. And parasympathetic ganglion fibers are carried almost entirely within the vagus nerve, and they're divided into superior, middle and inferior branches before it supplies to the heart, from the brain to the heart. Coming to intrinsic, you have many intrinsic sympathetic and parasympathetic. Throughout the heart, numerous heart ganglia are present. Each ganglion contains about 200 to 1000 neurons, and they form synapses with the sympathetic and parasympathetic fibers within the pericardial space in the tissue. You can see there's a vast majority of these ganglion are organized in the ganglion GP on the surface of the atria and the ventricle. You can see here posterior lateral left atrial GP, and you have the posterior right atrial GP. There are a number of on the pericardium, and these GP may function as the integration center that modulates intricate autonomic nervous system interaction between eccentric and the intrinsic autonomic nervous system. With that background of vagus nerve, now another few slides I'm going to talk about autonomic nervous system. We all know that autonomic nervous system controls or coordinate every system of the human body, and it causes the homeostasis. But the physicians have been manipulating their patients with ANS for decades. To name few, it may be adrenergic, cholinergic, agonist or antagonist, or in psychiatry, they use right and left SSRI, tricyclic. So these are the one which causes autonomic dysfunction. We have done a study, Dr. Kavira Gurupa in his thesis, he has done a study where he used the heart rate variability as a tool to see the effect of drug in a drug-naive depressive patient. So what we found out is, in a drug-naive patient, when you give SSRI, there was a little bit alteration of the autonomic nervous system, either it is tricyclic or SSRI, but a tricyclic PCA had more autonomic dysfunction after the giving the drug. So by this, a physiologist can convey to the psychiatrist that before they start TCA for the treatment for the depression, ideally they should know the what is heart rate variability of that particular patient. Then they can recommend the tricyclic drug for the patient. So coming back to the autonomic nervous system, sympathetic mediates mediated by generally by stress. So it's also called the fight and the flight, and increases the metabolic rate. Specifically, peripheral vasoconstriction increases the heart rate, contractility, raises the blood pressure, dilates the pupil and bronchi, releases the gluconeogenesis, glucose from the stores, and epinephrine, non-epinephrine, decreases the salivation, GI motility, and relaxes the bladder. Then when you stimulate the parasympathetic, or what is the nature of parasympathetic is, in general, it is rest and relaxation, and it is seen better in the recovery in the disease, decreases the metabolic rate. Specifically, peripheral vasodilation decreases the heart rate, contractility, and constricts the pupil. And it conserves this glucose and stimulates the salivation and GI motility, and also contracts the bladder, and it mediates ventilation. So in yoga, the subject who does the long-term yoga, you can see they have a high parasympathetic activity compared to the parasympathetic activity. Coming with this little bit background of autonomic nervous system, now let us see what are the evaluation of the autonomic system, why we have to do the evaluation of the autonomic nervous system. Mainly to determine whether autonomic function is normal or abnormal, if abnormal, to assess the degree of dysfunction, and also see the what level it is that dysfunction is there. In the first slide I showed you, autonomic nervous system has got vast function because it starts supplying the eye to the rectum, and it is extremely complex to evaluate all the tests. And another important thing is, because postganglionic fibers is unmyelinated, they cannot be tested directly by the conventional neurophysiological technique like nerve conduction study or electromyography. See, this both sympathetic and parasympathetic system arises from the brain, and it comes back, parasympathetic is from the T1 to L2, then it comes out of the spinal cord and it forms a paravertebral ganglion. So here, up to there is a preganglionic fibers. From the paravertebral ganglion, it travels very vastly to the different target organ. So these postganglionic fibers are unmyelinated or very less myelinated. So when the nerves are unmyelinated, you cannot do conventional neurophysiological technique. Of course, unmyelinated also can be done with the insertion of the needle, but it is a little bit cumbersome. Coming to the how do we evaluate autonomic nervous system? It's a conventional method. It's called the Ewing's protocol. The deep breathing testing is one of the tests for the vagus nerve. And Valsalva maneuver, you have the two components. One is the blood pressure component and the heart rate component. There are four stages of Valsalva maneuver. If you want to look into the parasympathetic, you have to look into the heart rate component. So Valsalva test can be used for both sympathetic and the parasympathetic. Then orthostatic test can be used again for sympathetic and parasympathetic. What happens orthostatic test? If you record the blood pressure or if you comment on the blood pressure, that reflects the sympathetic activity. And if you comment on the heart rate, that reflects the parasympathetic activity. Of course, isometric contraction is the purely sympathetic and it does not reflect the parasympathetic. And the cold pressor test is again, it is the sympathetic test. And another one, you have mental arithmetic test. That again, if you look into the blood pressure, sympathetic activity, and if you do heart rate variability in mental arithmetic stress test, the heart rate variability will give you the both the component of the sympathetic and the parasympathetic. Coming to after the conventional test, you have the heart rate variability. This I'll be talking a little bit in detail about the heart rate variability. Another test we look into the autonomic functions is blood pressure variability and baroreceptor sensitivity. And we have a pseudomotor examination and also by the imaging and the other technique. Pseudomotor function can be done by the QSAT or thermoregulatory sweat test also. Or you can do the SSR also, you can do the pseudomotor test. With that background, I'll move on to the heart rate variability. Heart rate, all of us know that heart rate is not a constant entity. Physiological and pathological phenomena variation in the time interval between the heart rate can be measured with heart rate variability. And the main aim is to maintain the internal milieu. In this diagram, you can see if this is the RR interval, the RR interval, if the RR interval is 0.5859, then the heart rate is 70. In other words, if it is 0.793, the heart rate is 76. So this is depends upon the RR interval. When I examine my pulse, I can comment my heart rate is 80, 90, 100 or 60. I can say it is tachycardia or bradycardia, but I cannot comment what is the cause of. So if I say my heart rate is 100, I say tachycardia. I don't know what is the cause of tachycardia. The tachycardia means increase in the heart rate. So this increase in the heart rate can be done or can be influenced by sympathetic. Sympathetic stimulation also causes heart rate increase or parasympathetic withdrawal. We know that parasympathetic system vagus nerve is a cardio inhibitory. The intrinsic capacity of the SA node to beat is maybe around 160 to 180. The moment it is innervated with the vagus nerve, the heart rate comes to around 80. So whenever the suppression action of the vagus is removed, then also it can increase in the heart rate. So in a clinical setup, when we record the pulse, we cannot comment why is the heart rate is increased or decreased. For that, heart rate variability is very, very important. So coming to history of heart rate variability, I'll just run. So it started as beginning of the Ayurvedic medicine before the BC, and later on number of studies have come. Finally, in 1996, the task force has come up with a very good article, and recently in 2016-17, the second edition also has come. We can get all the detail how to measure, how to interpret the heart rate variability. Coming to the measurement, we take the long lead two artifact-free recordings. The sampling rate should be 1024 to get an ideal HRV. I know people are doing with 512 also, but ideally it should be that 1024 to get a good proper heart rate variability. And these are the how it happens. We are going to record time domain and the frequency domain analysis with the heart rate variability. So in time domain also, you have a statistical and geometric, that is SDNN, RMSSD, SD and NN50. And in frequency domain, autoregressive model and the non-parametric. But commonly, the most commonly used parameters is the SDNN and the fast Fourier transformation. For this FFT, we require a software, either it can be AD instrument or QBOs, or any software is required to do the heart rate variability. In case you don't have any software, you have even to record the digital ECG. If you don't have, you can take a lead two ECG for 5 minutes, the manual one with the paper strip one, and then calculated SDNN, that is RR interval, you keep on entering in the Excel sheet, and then you look into SD of the RR interval, root mean square of the RR interval. With this, even if the infrastructure do not provide you digital ECG or the software, still you can comment on heart rate variability, especially this statistical time domain you can comment. So the time domain is the standard deviation. I've already mentioned root mean square and NN50 and PNN50. And the frequency domain is the total power, ultra low frequency, very low frequency, high frequency powers. And is always better to express as a normalized unit. If I say a person is 100 kilos and another person is 80 kilo, you cannot say that 100 kilo person is a heavy. Maybe he's very tall. So what we say, we always express as a BMI. In the same way, in heart rate variability, ideally we should express with the normalized unit. And another important parameter is the sympathovagal balance. So this is the 5 minutes recording, 0 to 300 beats. So this fluctuation is referred as a short-term heart rate variability. So then this is passed to the spectral analysis. 0.04 to 0.04 to 15 is called the low band, low frequency band, and the high frequency band. And you calculate the LF-HF ratio. This is how it is plotted, HF and LF. And this is the 24 hours recording with the different parameters. See, if you use any software, either it can be AD or QBOs, whatever it is, it will give all these parameters, low frequency, very low frequency, everything. But we should not give value for VLF and the very low frequency and ultra low frequency with the 5 minutes recording. With 5 minutes recording, you can comment on LF-HF ratio only, because VLF and ultra low frequency as influenced by circadian rhythm and many other factors. So this is how they are going to measure, and this is how we are going to calculate the NU. This is the formula. Autonomic balance LF-HF ratio, this is a low frequency has got both the component of parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system, whereas HF has got only the parasympathetic. But the recent studies have shown that even to some extent, sympathetic has got effect on high frequency also. So this table shows you the standard deviation sensitivity for all the variation, and SDNN is maintains the 5 minutes recording. RMSSD and PNN50 reflects the high frequency, that is the vagus nerve. If you want to look into the time domain analysis, if you want to comment on the parasympathetic, these two parameters has to be taken. And this is the frequency domain analysis. Total power is the variability of everything. High frequencies, mainly parasympathetic. Low frequencies, both sympathetic, parasympathetic. And very low frequency, thermal regulation is there. Ultra low frequency, you have a parasympathetic pain, also the postural changes. And LH-HF ratio is the sympathovagal balance. And with this RR interval, we can play number of mathematical game. And because in every thesis, LF-HF ratio monotonous, if your PG wants to do something else, they can do triangular, index, non-index, all those things. This is the mathematical. You have the RR interval, you apply all other formula, get the different values. So in sympathovagal balance, sympathetic is heart rate increases, myocardial contractile increases, peripheral resistance increases, catecholamine increases. Whereas when you stimulate the parasympathetic vagus nerve, heart rate decreases. In this slide, you can see the resting HF is more, LF is less. The moment it is tilted, you can see almost it was equal earlier. After tilt, LF component is more compared to the HF component. So heart rate, I have another 5 minutes, 5 to 10, 6 minutes. Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Please.
Yeah. The heart rate variability. We are at NIMHANS. We have done number of studies both in healthy volunteers and in the disease. So heart rate decreases with the age, insulin levels, reduced baroreceptor sensitivity, physical activity, rapid and shallow breathing, smoking, depression. This list goes on number of pages you can write. Here I would like to share one or two paper what we published in a health, one or two in healthy volunteers and other in the disease. And we did work on the influence of age and gender in autonomic regulation. So in Indian data, we didn't have always used to take a UK data because they had 180 subjects and we used to take their references. And when we do our study, we want to have our own normative data. So we had 189 subjects. So it starts from above 10 up to 60 years. Because after 60 years, autonomic dysregulation normally can occur. So up to age of 60 years, we collected 104 males and 75 females. They were analyzed for both time domain and the frequency domain analysis. What we could see is loss of vagal tone with the aging process. So can you see here, as the age increases, the vagal tone decreased. That was seen with the two parameters, SDNN and RMSSD. These are the two parameters which reflects the vagal activity. So what we concluded is, as the age increases, the vagal tone decreases. And also the diminishing tone, the total power also decreased. LHHF also decreased. Whereas sympathetic dominance was increased along with the age. It's statistically significant. And when you compare the two different genders, we found higher vagal tone in the females because they are all, most of them are the reproductive age. So that is another cardiac protective for the females. You don't see the MI before the menopause, or it is there, but comparatively, if you compare the men and the women, the people who undergo with MI, the females are more cardioprotective, because in a normal healthy individual, we found vagal tone was increased in the females. So in another study in a healthy volunteer, what we did it in the neurosurgeons. In our own neurosurgeons, we repeatedly did, we took it in the clipping of the aneurysm. Is a very, very stressful surgery, neurosurgery, in a aneurysm. So what we found is, during the clipping of the aneurysm, the heart rate went up to 180 per minute, 200 per minute. This is very, very alarming. We thought they are under stress and that could be the reason why the heart rate is increased. So when we did the analysis, it was uniformly our neurosurgeons, there was a withdrawal of the parasympathetic. Hence the heart rate was increased. So we gave the suggestion, you have to improve your parasympathetic power. How to increase the parasympathetic power? Exercise, yoga, meditation, because we have got the proof that a people, normal healthy individual, doing the meditation, doing the pranayama, doing the yoga therapy, yoga, they have increased the parasympathetic activity. Hence, we suggested our neurosurgeon, go for an exercise. Much more than exercise, if you do yoga and meditation, that will increase their thing. In another study, healthy volunteers, I would like to share, what we did is the children of alcohol, first degree children of alcohol, that is, if the parents are alcohol, whether father or father or a mother, children is alcohol, we studied the heart rate variability. First, we did the resting heart rate variability in the both sample, that is, healthy volunteer children and alcoholic children, but both the groups are healthy volunteers. At the resting state, both are normal. Then we gave the mental arithmetic task for them. The common uniform, when we give the mental arithmetic task, we found out these children of alcoholic, they were very, very subtly increased in the sympathetic activity. And even this normal healthy also, they were increased. But what was the we found was, they didn't come down. The children of alcoholic, they were stressed even after the test had been withdrawn. Whereas in healthy volunteer children, it has come down. So why we did this, we can say to the parents, those who are alcoholic to increase their calmness and increase the heart rate variability by doing the normal physiological exercise and yoga. So next we did in number of healthy disease, it can be a Parkinson's or in movement disorder, that list goes on. Now I'll conclude my talk. What are the limitations of the heart rate variability? Here the key feature is we looked into the HF, that's a key parameter. And we know that validity variability of the HF represents the cardiac vagal tone. But nowadays, I told you, even the little bit component of sympathetic is also involved in the HF, so we're still doubtful. And HRV analysis generates a large parameters. In the one of the slides I showed, NN50, PNNFT, SDNN, etc., etc. And then in the frequency domain, NU, everything. So you have a large parameters. It will be confusing for the research. And another drawback is the parameters show the non-distribution. Sometimes your mean is lesser than the standard deviation. So then that will be difficult to give for the sampling size. And then you have overall, this HRV result is a stereotype. And then you say in epilepsy it decreased, in depression it is increased. So it's always surrounding around LF-HF ratio, it's a stereotype. And the rise, this rise possibility of the HRV is an epiphenomenon. And there could be methodological issue like an ectopy, respiratory, body movements, and also the diurnal variation. You have to see, whenever you do designing experimental, if you have done pre-test at one particular time, kindly follow that you are going to use the same time for the post-test also. You cannot do pre-test at 9 o'clock, post-test at 2 o'clock. Because the diurnal variation also will give the false results. So when you're designing the study, please see that pre and post done at the same time. And nevertheless, these things like an ectopy, temperature, all those things can be designed, handled carefully with the designing the study. And to conclude, HRV is a non-invasive, robust and independent physiological marker of the autonomic tone. Mainly, it is the parasympathetic activity with the vagus, and it can be used as a biomarker for the pseudo death and also a tool to classify the heart diseases. And it is a potential indicator for psychophysiological stress. And this is a very, very suitable for the telemedicine. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your insightful talk. So now our next session will be from Dr. Kaviraj Udupa. He is the additional professor from Department of Neurophysiology, NIMHANS. He has completed his MBBS from Mysore Medical College and MD Physiology from Jipmer Pondicherry. He has completed his PhD in Neurophysiology from NIMHANS again. And also he completed his postdoctoral fellowship in Clinical Neurophysiology from Dr. Chen's lab, University of Toronto. After all, he has joined back in NIMHANS as an additional professor, and his research interests include non-invasive brain stimulation, autonomic functions, mood and movement disorders, yoga and Ayurveda. He has 90 papers and 1718 citations and H-index value of 23 against his credit. He also got various fellowships and awards that includes Professor Rene Distel Award, Professor James Sharp Award, PGIBMS Award, CIHR Fellowship, Elizabeth Barford Fellowship in Neurological Sciences. I would like to call Dr. Kaviraj Udupa to deliver the talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Kanagraj. I would like to thank Sumant Bhatt and his team, Sandeep Kanagraj and others, Media Instruments, for hosting this. And I would like to thank the chairperson, Professor Satya Prabha, who has elegantly discussed with you the vagus nerve and how we can assess the vagal involvement in various neuropsychiatric disorders. Also would like to thank Professor Venkat, who has accepted our invitation to give talk on the transcutaneous auricular vagal nerve stimulation, which will be followed by Not able to share the screen. The host disabled participant screen sharing. Can you enable that? So I'm going to talk on vagus nerve stimulation in terms of neurological perspective. So Madam has nicely talked on the vagus. So here I would briefly touch upon the non-invasive brain stimulation techniques. I won't go into details, but briefly summarize. Then upon vagal nerve stimulation, and mainly talk on the invasive mode of stimulation. Of course, our guest faculty, Professor Venkat sir, is going to talk on non-invasive measures and some of the ongoing studies and some future collaborative studies that we are planning with the Venkat's laboratory, and the combination of different NIVS modes that we are thinking of and some of the future directions. So basically, a non-invasive brain stimulation is getting lots of importance because as we all know, the brain and the spinal cord and the central nervous system is a collection of electrical networks that we can say, and we can stimulate using either magnetic or the electrical stimulation. So electrical stimulation with the brain, it is a bit tough as we need to increase the voltage to penetrate the scalp tissue, but when it comes to these nerves, we can stimulate using electrical stimulation. So vagal nerve stimulation or transcutaneous various nerve stimulation, which is there in the nerve conduction studies, as well as spinal cord stimulation, is becoming very popular nowadays. Of course, with the TMS, we can study the brain and its physiology. It's a different topic per se, so I won't go into the details of that. So when we plot the temporal resolution in y-axis and spatial resolution in x-axis, the techniques like optogenetics or microstimulations will allow us to get very finer spatial as well as the temporal resolution, but we can't do it in a clinical population. Of course, we can do some amount of microstimulation in patients undergoing surgeries, epileptic surgery or other deep brain stimulation surgeries, but when we are dealing with the patients, we roughly end up with using these non-invasive modes like various direct current stimulation or alternating current stimulation or vagal nerve stimulation. Of course, when we are dealing with the lesion or drug manipulation, we are compromising. We need to compromise with both spatially as well as temporally. So vagal nerve stimulation is in a way is a very nice way we can even explore as well as treat patients with various conditions. So vagal nerve stimulation, basically it started with surgical implantation of vagus nerve at the neck area. But nowadays we are even getting non-invasive modes, which will be dealt in more detail with Katsar in his talk after mine. And there are handheld devices as well as the transauricular vagal nerve stimulation is shown here. The handheld devices are here. So vagal nerve stimulation basically is stimulating the vagus nerve, basically stimulating the vagus efferents with the frequency of around 25 to 30 hertz, so that the efferents are not stimulated, only the afferents are stimulated. And we need to put a battery around the subclavicular fossa, which can be programmed either by a programmer outside the body, and we can have different parameters of stimulation. Of course, the non-implantable vagus nerve stimulation is coming out for various conditions, and it has been some of these are handheld devices, some are like put over the auricular region. So vagus nerve stimulation is very important, as Madam has shown in her initial slides, how vagus is going to innervate various thoracic and abdominal viscera. And of course, the 80% of these fibers are efferent fibers, which I'm going to show in subsequent slides. And this efferent stimulation has a very important role, as they are going to connect to various regions in the brain. And it has been studied in various disorders like anxiety, Alzheimer's disease, migraine, fibromyalgia, stroke, obesity, and various other disorders. Of course, the FDA has approved it in for epilepsy and depression and anxiety, insomnia. The European CE approval has been given for various other conditions like pain, addiction, bronchoconstriction, and gastric motility disorders. And many research laboratories around the globe are working in various conditions to understand the importance of vagus nerve stimulation per se. So I'll briefly touch upon the condition which has already been proven, like epilepsy, especially in focal epilepsy, it has been used, and also some of the epilepsy syndromes. Compared to the adverse effects, it is far less compared to, of course, patients usually treated with the drugs per se. Initially, when medically refractory, these modes are going to be involved. And this is the, the flow chart showing medical therapy is tried first. When they are refractory to this, then a surgical evaluation is done. And if they are appropriate, they are going to given the deep brain stimulation or some other modes of surgery. Whereas if this surgery is not appropriate, then VNS. And even some of the patients who are after surgery also are not seizure free, they will be offered this VNS as a therapy. And again, there are various hypotheses how exactly vagal nerve stimulation afferents get activated and various regions of the brain, including the tractus solitarius, locus coeruleus, the parabrachial nucleus, and how they are going to change upon various networks, the GABAergic or the neurotransmitters like norepinephrine the somatosensory growth potential. Various studies have been shown to alter both at the molecular as well as the system network level the changes happening with vagal nerve stimulation, and various hypotheses have been put forward. And compared to other invasive modes like the anterior deep brain stimulation or cortical responsive stimulation, the side effects is around 1 to 5%, and it is mainly because of the stimulation at the neck region, coughing, infection, or hoarseness of the voice. The temporary vocal cord palsy are the more important side effects. Even animal models have been put forward in understanding vagal nerve stimulation as a rehabilitative tool in a stroke, and studies have shown with vagal nerve stimulation the stroke rehabilitation improved with increased neural plasticity on the opposite side. And even studies have shown when it is combined, here the physiotherapist is giving the vagal nerve stimulation through this wireless transporter, which activates the patient's vagal nerve stimulation. And if he is doing along with that the rehabilitative techniques, be at home or at the clinic, it has shown improvement and compared to the sham or the control VNS, the patient's clinical scores have been improved. So lots of studies have been done. So now coming to the various stimulation parameters, as I told, the stimulation of around 25 to 30 hertz is the one suited to stimulate the afferent regions with the intensity of 0.25 to 3.5 milliamperes. Again, this has to be tailor-made for the given patient, for a given condition. Various other parameters like pulse width, on time or off time is set depending on the clinical outcome. Madam has shown this extensively how vagus has its efferent over various thoracic and abdominal viscera, but we are interested in this efferent stimulation with that particular frequency, so that in addition to the efferents are taking efferents, 80% of the fibers are efferent fibers from various thoraco abdominal viscera, and lots of been in the recent works in the gut brain axis, and now pro-inflammatory cytokines and other immunological markers affects this, and in turn affects various neurological conditions have been worked. And some of these things have already been covered, and of course this is the vagus nerve with the relations to the common carotid artery for implantation of the invasive vagal nerve stimulation. Non-invasive things will be covered in the next talk. And the handheld devices are held like this, and it is held over the vagus nerve in the neck region, whereas transauricular thing is going to be covered in the next talk. And it has been shown to have effects in various other conditions like migraine. Of course, the evidence is 11U. It is being saying that it's not very conclusive, as some of the studies are not shown. And this is ongoing research. Lots of studies are being done. And important ones, how this particular apparatus stimulation has an effect on the autonomic nervous system, that we are planning to do at our center. And basically here they are done with the micro neurographic recording. And during stimulation, you can see how that is going to be altered. Of course, as Madam pointed out, we are doing autonomic functions in various disorders. This is one of the conditions of depression. We studied both the conventional as well as heart-related measures, and showing depression patients having abnormal autonomic activity. And this can be one of the ways how we can do to go about is by stimulating the vagal nerve stimulation. And this particular study we are planning. And of course, we have treated with other modes of antidepressant therapies, including the repetitive transcranial magnetic stimulation, and autonomic markers have been changed with different modes of therapy, and there is some kind of correlation with the post-treatment MADRS score to that of the sympathovagal balance. So lots of research needs to be done in the area how exactly these neuropsychiatric disorders get affected with vagal nerve, and how vagal nerve stimulation can be useful. Of course, here we have used vagus nerve stimulation, but compared TDCS with the ITPS, and it's been shown to be improved in our patient with the depression. And other mode is yoga and Ayurveda. It's also we have integrative center, integrative medicine department, where different modes of complementary therapies like yoga and Ayurveda have been combined. And in this particular study, we are showing the Shirodhara having effects. And here again, there will be, as Madam has shown, the somatic efferents are there in various regions over the head and neck area, mainly around the auricle region. So stimulating those might have effect on the vagus, and we need to complement this along with of course, the molecular studies can be done in the animal models. We have vagal nerve stimulation also being done in animal models of depression. Professor Shankar and Dr. Shri Kumar is working on this particular study. But this particular study done in other center has shown how the vagal nerve stimulation in animal models affected mainly the neurogenesis in the hippocampal regions. This particular kind of studies have also been planned in our center. Summarize, basically activating various immunological markers in the gut-brain axis, which in turn activates the vagal efferents. And when we combine that with the vagal nerve stimulation, so we have wide spread effects over the HPA axis, over the various brain regions, and could be used. As this cartoon shows, 80% of the efferent fiber activation that we are targeting in the vagus nerve stimulation. Of course, all these efferents are coming from various thoraco-abdominal viscera, and their inflammatory markers, the gut microbiota, and various other immunological things have effect over the integrity of the nervous system, and it has effect over various neuropsychiatric disorders that we need to explore further. So for the lack of time, I won't go into the details of this immunological markers, mainly through the tumor necrosis factor alpha and JAK-STAT and the NF-kappa-B pathways that in turn affects the gut neuromicrobiota, as well as the immunological pathways, and that has effect over the vagal nerve vagal nerves per se and vagus nerve stimulation can activate all these and could affect the brain in various neuropsychiatric disorders. So far, VNS application has proven benefits in intractable epilepsy, mainly the treatment-resistant or medical refractory epilepsy, as well as treatment-resistant depression, memory and cognition, obesity, and neurogenesis. But we need to explore this in various other disorders. And of course, when combining with the lifestyle mechanisms, including the ones in our tradition, Indian tradition, yoga and Ayurveda, there are lots of things we can study, especially with the meditation, Ayurveda, yoga, how they activate this vagal afferents in various means, of course, with the gut microbiota or the neuro, immuno, endocrine, or all these axes have effects on the autonomic nervous system per se, and could be explored in various neurological and psychiatric conditions. So it's a very exciting area of research we need to carry out. We are in a way running the various studies in this mode, and we need to explore as a holistic mechanism how gastrointestinal, immunological, integrative medicine affect these various neuropsychiatric disorders. Of course, vagus nerve stimulation has given us a window to explore the functions of the brain as well as to treat various neurological and psychiatric disorders which are medical refractory, not responding well to the medications. So it's an exciting area of electrophysiology to understand all these system and use it for the benefit of patients with the various neurological and psychiatric disorders. I would like to thank you all for your kind attention, and I would like to acknowledge all members of our autonomic lab as well as NIBS lab at NIMHANS. I'd like to thank all the funding agencies and patients and the caregivers and the volunteers. This is our team at the autonomic lab taking during the last year's meeting here. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for sharing your knowledge and resources. It was very informative. Hope the participants enjoyed it. The next session is from Dr. G. Venkatesh Subramaniam. He is a professor from psychiatry department, NIMHANS. He has completed his MBBS degree from Stanley Medical College, Chennai, MD in psychiatry from NIMHANS, and a PhD also in psychiatry from NIMHANS. He is currently heading Translational Psychiatry Lab and also coordinator for INSTAR program and Visor Neuromodulation program in NIMHANS. His research interests are schizophrenia, transcranial direct current stimulation, brain imaging, clinical neurobiology, psychopharmacology, and metabolic syndrome. He has 325 plus PubMed indexed publications, 6,648 citations, and H-index value of 42 against his credit. Also, he has awarded with various awards and fellowships, including National Bioscience Award for Career Development from DBT, the recent one, Dr. Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize for Medical Sciences, DST Swarna Jayanti Fellowship, ICMR Vidyasagar Award, Wellcome Trust DBT India Alliance Senior Fellowship, IPS Young Psychiatric Award, INSA Young Scientist Medal, NASI Young Scientist Award, DBT Innovative Young Biotechnologist Award, IPS Marfashia Award, ICMR Tilak Venkobar Rao Award, Bhagavat Award, Scopus Young Scientist, IPS Tilak Venkobar Rao Oration. Now I would call upon Dr. G. Venkatesh Subramaniam to deliver his talk. Thank you.
Good afternoon. At the outset, I wish to thank Dr. Kaviraj and Professor Satyaprabha for this invite and opportunity. Let me share my screen now. So I'll be talking about transcutaneous auricular vagal nerve stimulation in psychiatry. I'll spend a minute tracing the origins of electrotherapy, looking at the historical perspectives. If you look at the history, early records show that the Roman physician Scribonius Largus became aware of the potential to use electricity to lessen the pain. And this has been recorded as early as in 43 AD. His writings include the story of a man who found himself relieved of gout pain after accidentally stepping on a torpedo fish. So what we see here on the left-hand panel of the slide is the torpedo fish, which can give a significant electric shock. Consequently, Scribonius and his contemporaries both experimented with the use of these electric fish for the treatment of headaches. So we have moved from torpedo fish to TDCS, or transcranial direct current stimulation, which Dr. Kaviraj alluded to in his presentation. Fortunately, the science of electrical therapy evolved much, much beyond sticking a fish to a patient's forehead. In the 17th century, the first methods of controllable artificial electricity production were developed, and the records show one Aldini completed a study in which he used an early form of TDCS to the treatment of melancholia. What we see here in this slide on the left-hand panel is perhaps the ancient version of a neuromodulation, something which is equivalent to the transcranial direct current stimulation. With advances in science, it has become a pocket-sized equipment. So that brings us to the present day, where we are looking forward towards neuroscience-informed psychiatric treatments, especially given the potential increase in our knowledge about the brain basis of cognition behavior. More than ever, there is a compelling need for a neuroscience-informed approach to understand and treat psychiatric disorders. These discoveries in neuroscience are ably matched with advances in neurotechnologies. And such advances have created novel avenues to assess the brain, as well as generated a fascinating set of brain stimulation devices and also techniques that can modulate neural circuits. Very importantly, we also need to be aware that the pipeline for newer psychopharmacological agents have almost become dry, and the challenges of treatment resistance, especially in psychiatry, has become quite imminent. So this has made what is called as an interventional psychiatry to gain increasing prominence in the recent times. If you look at interventional psychiatry, it has two significant components. The first being harnessing the potential of neurotechnologies to elucidate the circuit level brain dysfunction, which help us to understand the pathogenetic basis of psychiatric disorders. Very importantly, the second component helps us to translate this understanding through application of disparate brain stimulation techniques to modulate the aberrant brain circuits. Contextually, it is interesting to note that the brain may be conceptualized as an electrochemical soup. However, modulating the electro component has not been intensively pursued to match the psychopharmacological intervention that have targeted the chemical component. Hence, it is high time that the interventional potential in psychiatry deserves its due credit on par with other medical specialties. That brings us to the central theme of today's presentation in terms of looking at a novel non-invasive neuromodulation technique, that is transcutaneous auricular vagus nerve stimulation. These host of NIBS, that are non-invasive brain stimulation technique that are based on electricity, is implicated upon this concept: weak direct current can modulate neuroplasticity. And there are several lines of evidence, right from fundamental experiments to animal model studies, that robustly support weak intensity electrical stimulation can have profound effects on neurons. If you look at the more popular technique in this spectrum, it is TDCS, which is a non-invasive safe technique that involves application of low intensity direct current. And these techniques essentially modulate neuroplasticity, which is fundamentally the neurophysiological process through which the brain adapts to changing environment by altering its molecular and structural features. And especially if you look at psychiatric disorders, the neurotransmitter signaling pathways, whether it involves glutamate, dopamine, or GABA, they are implicated in several of the psychiatric disorders. And very significantly, these neurotransmitter signaling pathways closely interact with the neural plasticity signaling pathways. And there are several studies, including the one that is showed in the slide, that shows electrical current can modulate plasticity. And if we look at several types of transcranial electrical stimulation techniques, we have TDCS, TACS, or transcranial alternating current stimulation, TRNS, or the transcranial random noise stimulation, and the transcranial pulsed current stimulation. The fourth one, that is the transcranial pulsed current stimulation, which I mentioned, is something which is very closely utilized in non-invasive modulation of vagus nerve. We have been working on all these weak intensity electrical current stimulation using this paradigm of Weiser, which can be expanded as weak intensity stimulation for enhancement and reintegration, through which we have been launching and doing several studies involving various kinds of neuromodulation techniques to treat psychiatric disorders. Now, when we look at these TES, or the transcranial electrical stimulation techniques, they also are found to have rather inadvertent effect on cranial nerves. If you look at the TES techniques, they apply current through electrodes on the scalp with the primary purpose of intended direct stimulation of the brain in order to modulate cortical function with resultant changes in behavior and cognition. But due to the physics of TES, there occurs much lower current density in the brain than in the skin and skull foramina. This actually can result in the stimulation of cranial nerves that either traverse the skin or go near the foramina between the electrodes. Suppose if you look at the TES effects on cranial nerves, there are some interesting examples which propose that the TDCS for the treatment of major depressive disorder, when it is applied bilaterally to the forehead, it may actually be stimulating some of the cranial nerves that innervate the forehead region. And there are several such examples. So this has made people to look at this interesting opportunity, whether the cranial nerves can by themselves be special targets for neuromodulation, especially because of the bottom-up effects that can cause because of the peripheral stimulation of these nerves. And as we all know, and very nicely portrayed by Professor Satya Prabha, the anatomy of the vagus nerve, there are several places this nerve becomes accessible and comes to the surface of the body. And these are essentially direct afferents to the cerebrum. So we have an excellent situation where we can modulate the brain through the window of cranial nerves. The summary which has been portrayed in this slide shows how several of the cranial nerves can have some kind of impact on various areas of the cortex as well as the subcortical region, through the purported mechanism of bottom-up neuroregulation. Coming to vagus nerve, as again, it was quite nicely summarized by Professor Satyaprabha, this is the longest cranial nerve, and this is made up of as much as about 80% sensory afferents. And when we look at the relevance of vagal nerve stimulation for psychiatric disorders, in those patients that were treated with VNS for epilepsy, there were clinical reports of improvement in mood, and this improvement were not necessarily correlated with change in seizure symptoms. And this encouraged further clinical trials to examine the application of VNS in several neuropsychiatric disorders. And these developments in turn encouraged advancements in non-invasive vagal nerve stimulation technology. If you look at the non-invasive vagus nerve stimulation, there are significant advantages because a minimally invasive or skin-based stimulation of vagus nerve will reduce the risk associated with surgical implant procedures, reduce the cost of maintenance of the device and post-operative care of the patient, and it will also help to facilitate application of this relatively safe procedure across a wide range of disorders and populations. Coming to the non-invasive application of VNS, that is the vagus nerve stimulation, it essentially targets either the auricular branch of the vagus nerve or the cervical branch. Transcutaneous auricular vagal nerve stimulation uses electrodes that are typically placed on the ear, whereas non-invasive vagus nerve stimulation is generally a broad term that is typically used to describe technology variants that places bipolar electrodes over the neck. As we all know, the vagus nerve has a component of innervation that spreads into the neck region as well. So this figure summarizes the different boundaries of innervation if you look at the profile, anatomical profile in the pinna. And what we see in the center, the green highlighted region, is the place where we have the innervation by the auricular branch of the vagus nerve. And transcutaneous auricular vagal nerve stimulation uses electrodes that are typically placed on the ear, that is either in the position which is denoted by the tragus, that is A1, or on the symbaconcave, which is denoted as A2. And if you look at the different kind of stimulus parameters, what we see here is a typical parameter of a pulsed current of 500 millisecond pulse width, with the usual current strength being lesser than 10 milliampere. And there are variants of this parameter when we look at the cervical non-invasive vagus nerve stimulation. A very important point I want to emphasize here is that the parameter space for the non-invasive vagus nerve stimulation is very broad, and there are lots of research requirements in this area towards formulating an informed approach in choosing the parameters in terms of identified translational applications. If you compare the neurobiological effects of TAVNS, or the transcutaneous auricular vagus nerve stimulation, versus the invasive VNS, there are neuroimaging studies that have shown that the brain regions activated by both these techniques greatly overlap. Namely, decreased activation in the limbic system, which includes the amygdala, hippocampus, and parahippocampal gyrus, and increased activity in thalamus and insula. Coming to some of the clinical application of TAVNS in psychiatry, the most researched disorder is the major depressive disorder. As we see in this slide, a randomized controlled pilot study reported in MDD patients, that is the major depressive disorder patient, in a sham controlled experiment. While both the active and sham group showed improvement, the active group improved much, much more than the sham group. There is also a single blind study that reported the effects of TAVNS on the default mode network using resting state functional MRI. Essentially, in this resting state fMRI study, what was shown is that the improvements on depression rating scale correlated with changes in the degree of connectivity in the default mode network. For some of us that are not familiar with default mode network, it is essentially a functionally connected network of brain areas that are engaged when the mind is reflected inward and not focused on a particular task. So it is proposed that the effects of TAVNS on major depressive disorder may work through modulation of the default mode network. An important clinical point to be noted here is, in contrast to the invasive VNS, which is limited to the treatment of resistant depression, TAVNS can be applied in less severe cases of MDD. There are also very interesting studies that have shown TAVNS can have beneficial effects on memory, especially the associative memory was found to improve following a single session of TAVNS. And in this study, subjects were stimulated with TAVNS while being shown face name pair, which is a standard cognitive task. And the results of the study were considered as the first to describe improvements in memory function, even with a single session of TAVNS. TAVNS has been shown to have effects on other cognitive functions, namely the executive function and cognitive control. And these lines of evidence show that there is immense potential that we need to explore to understand how we can tap the cognition enhancement benefits of TAVNS. Coming to the future directions, at some level, when we look at these various types of newer technologies and non-invasive brain stimulation technique, it seems that the problems can be solved much, much easily. The problems of brain disorders can be solved much, much easily. But we always need to remember, if the brain were so simple we could understand it, we would be so simple we couldn't. So this is a famous statement by Lyle Watson, which portrays the profound complexities of the brain. And this is one fascinating organ which makes us to become humble, in the sense, the more we learn about the brain, the lesser we understand the less, and we have to do more and more research. In this context, if I have to quote some of the critiques that are published in contemporary literature, given the vagus nerve's reciprocal connections with both optical and physiological structures involved in parasympathetic response, a number of possible cognitive processes could be modulated by non-invasive vagus nerve stimulation, both top-down and bottom-up manner. However, because of the extensive and diverse targets of the vagus nerve, disambiguating the mechanisms of action for a given constellation of cognitive and behavior changes can be very challenging and indeed complex. Similarly, optimizing intervention to modulate a specific brain circuit for targeted outcomes, especially with a TAVNS, is in very, very early stages. And we need to do a lot of studies that can help us to identify certain translational biomarkers, say based on EEG or ERP approaches, which will help us to have a more refined and informed neurobiological approach. So in this context, computational neuroscience can be of immense help. And some of the techniques like resting state fMRI or task-based fMRI can be very, very helpful. And because the vagus nerve is implicated in a wide array of function, vagus nerve stimulation is being explored for an increasingly diverse range of application. And most importantly, these challenges reinforces the need to develop targeted interventions rather than expanding the same dose to produce a range of distinct outcomes, which essentially means that we need to factor in several variables that may influence the effect of such non-invasive brain stimulation techniques, which applies to TAVNS as well. And we need to move step by step from basic studies, which will help us to optimize and standardize the application parameters, towards more advanced and model-based studies, which in turn will help us to understand the causal relationship. To enable such advanced research and to answer some of these challenges, at least to take some of the first few steps in this area, I'm happy to share with the audience that we have recently received a very big grant from the DBT Wellcome Trust India Alliance, which is called as a Clinical Research Center for Neuromodulation and Psychiatry. Under this multi-center initiative, we propose to do cutting-edge studies across all types of brain stimulation techniques in psychiatry, and specifically for the early career researchers that are logged into this program, I wish to inform that this center has immense opportunity to get training in advanced neuromodulation techniques. There are potential opportunities to pursue PhD in the area of neuromodulation and psychiatry, and especially for those clinical track researchers who have completed their MBBS or MD, there are also fascinating and resourceful clinical research training fellowship. I request those people that are interested to please email us in the ID that is given below, that is ipsych.nimhans@gmail.com, to get more information. And with this, I wish to stop my presentation, and I thank Dr. Kaviraj as well as Professor Satyaprabha for this opportunity. It was really nice interacting with the team. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your insightful speech, and it was very knowledgeable, like to understand different stimulation techniques. So now we have a question and answer session. I would request Sumant to take on the questions, and any one of our panelists can answer the questions. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was a very detailed presentation from all three of you. So I would request Dr. Kaviraja to just have a look at the question and answer, so that we can answer some of them which are common.
Yes, this question is from Pratik Adya. So she wants to know about how to assess off-target effects. And another question is, she's working in animal models, and she wants to know more details on procuring the stimulating device in rats. We, in our department of neurophysiology, we are working on animal models of transcutaneous auricular vagal nerve stimulation, and I will get in touch with the people who are working in this particular group, Professor Shankar and Dr. Shrikumar. If you can email me, I will forward it to them, and you can get more details from where exactly you can get these animal model transcutaneous auricular vagal nerve stimulation things. Of course, off-target effects, we need to work on both. As you know, it is like when you are stimulating the vagus, it will have effect on the heart rate. So continuous recording of heart rate is needed. But basically, with the frequency and when you are doing invasive stimulation, of course, transauricular vagal nerve stimulation, those effects won't be there. But when you are doing invasive vagal nerve stimulation, you have to have the continuous ECG recording in order to get the heart rate, and also the parameters are specific to stimulate only the efferent, not the efferent, has to be maintained. That's the one question. And also during Madam's talk, I guess we had one question on how deep breathing, during deep breathing difference, how we can get both the effects of sympathetic and parasympathetic. So DBD, a deep breathing difference, the highest heart rate during inspiration and the least heart rate during expiration, it is basically an indicator of vagal activity. There are studies showing correlating high frequency activity to that of the deep breathing difference, and nice correlation. So of course, both limbs of autonomic nervous system, they work in tandem, and it is the effect of both. The DBD per se is considered as vagal effect. And also there was question on other frequencies like ultra low frequency and very low frequency. For these recordings, you have to have a longer duration of recording. So 24 hours of HRV recording is required for to comment anything on ultra low frequency, and basically the circadian rhythm will come into picture, and also other neuroendocrine effects will have also its role in very low frequencies and ultra low frequencies. The question from Nivedita, she wants to know whether the patients or subjects get resistant to continuous vagus stimulation over a period of time. Dr. Venkat, do you have an answer for that?
Thanks for this question. If you look at the brain stimulation techniques, there are very few techniques that have been examined for a longer period of time. There are reports of neuromodulation techniques, say, involving ECT as well as the TDCS, where the patients have been given repeated session in ECT over many months' time, and in TDCS over a period of years. So in those the techniques, resistance have not been documented. So with respect to vagus stimulation, there has not been any systematic study, at least with respect to the non-invasive stimulation for a longer period of time. But if I can translate some of the observations that are found in the other non-invasive brain stimulation technique, I wouldn't expect subjects to become resistant to the vagus stimulation. Perhaps with respect to the invasive vagus stimulation, Dr. Kaviraj can comment.
There won't be, as sir told, there won't be continuous stimulation. It is given on and off. So this kind of resistance, usually they won't get. But we need long-term studies to get more data on this aspect of resistance to the vagus nerve stimulation. There's a question on how derangement of vagus can lead to vascular dementia. In fact, this is a topic of the effect of vagus and vascular dementia is very interesting, and we'll be exploring this. We have an application for postdoctoral fellowship in this particular area. We'll be looking into that aspect. This question, I think, is to Satya Madam. Can you quote the study related to HRV and children of alcoholic parents? Madam, are you here?
Yeah. I can share the publication details in the question answer box, and they can go through that.
Yeah, this is published. Study.
Yeah, I'll share that.
There's a question in the chat box. Is there any study showing effect of BP, basically BP variation, I guess, after a stimulation of auricular branch vagus nerve transcutaneously? I'm sure people have worked on this aspect. Dr. Venkat, are you familiar with any such studies? Effect of BP?
I think such studies are ongoing. I am aware of studies that have shown heart rate variability.
Yeah, heart rate variability in these studies.
Yes, I am not aware of studies that have documented marked variations blood pressure. But I think we need to do more systematic review on this.
I think we need more studies in standardizing the various stimulation parameters and its immediate effect on various physiological measures and. As sir mentioned, more radiological measures also, and cognitive and other behavioral measures. I think that's it.
Yeah, thank you, sir. I think there was one question in the previous session on the normative values of the HRV. Can anyone please show some light on that?
Pardon me, tell me again.
Sir, they were asking on the normative values for the HRV. Like
that's again, madam has published a paper on that. We have normative data for Indian population.
Chat box has already given the publication detail in the chat box.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
So
thank you all for clearing the question and answer. So we have a small poll just to have an understanding, like how you found the session, and just to have an idea on the questions. I'll be just launching. I would request all the participants to participate. I hope you are able to see the questions.
While you are answering these questions, four questions, I would like to thank Professor Satyaprabha, the chairperson for this webinar, who has given encouragement and support to conduct this, and our guest faculty, Professor Venkata Subramanian, for his very extensive and useful presentation on TAVMS. I would like to thank, of course, AID Instruments, who hosted and effectively done this webinar without much of technical glitches. Of course, after Madam stopped, there was a bit of confusion. But we, most of we re-logged in, and we could continue effectively. And I would like to thank all the participants who participated very nicely and interacted with us. Please feel free to contact any one of us. As Venkata sir has so suggested, we have this neuromodulation center. So looking forward to have your association. I've also shared my email in the chat box if you want to contact me or madam, anyone in the autonomic field also you can contact. This is a question saying that are there any studies coupling fMRI and TDCS? Yes, I think Dr. Venkat's lab is working, published many studies in this regard. Dr. Venkat, do you want to comment on this?
We have completed a couple of studies, and they are in the publication process. These are studies that have looked at pre-post effects of TDCS. There are also studies that have looked at real-time application of MR-compatible TDCS as fMRI is being acquired. This is done by several other groups. So yes, studies are available, which combines both fMRI and TDCS in real-time, as well as to examine the treatment or the brain modulation effects. Thanks for the question.
Thank you, sir.
I'm just ending the poll. Kaviraj sir, would you like to just show some light on the answers for these questions?
Yeah, please project the answers.
I'm just sharing the results.
So that's 57% of the people have correctly answered sympathetic neurotransmitter. It is not always norepinephrine. The preganglionic transmitter is acetylcholine. Whereas in parasympathetic, it is always a stimulant. And vagus nerve stimulation is both invasive and non-invasive, as Venkata sir has nicely shown the non-invasive modes and given some understanding about invasive mode of stimulation. And VNS has potential utility in all these disorders like depression, epilepsy, migraine. Of course, many studies need to be done in migraine. This is just level new evidence, not very confirming evidence. But in depression and epilepsy, FDA and CE has approved vagus nerve stimulation. So the majority of the people have answered correctly. So I would like to congratulate all for getting some feel of the vagus and vagal nerve stimulation in neuropsychiatric disorders. Thank you. Thank you all for your time, and thank you for our co-panelists.
Thank you very much, Satya ma'am, Kaviraj sir, and Venk Subramaniam sir, for considering our invitation and giving us a valuable talk. So we hope to have some more sessions on the similar topics in the coming future. And also I would like to say that, like, since you already have the system, if you need any help from us on the customization of the stimulus protocol, so that we are happy to support anytime, please feel free to reach us. Thank you very much once again for
thank you.
Valuable talk. And for the participants, we I would like to say that we will send the email with the feedback form. So please fill up the form and revert, so that we'll be able to share the certificates. Thank you very much for your active participation. Thank you once again. Have a good day.
Thank you.